there may be signs indicating the name of that subdivision, 36 square feet for one exposed face, not to exceed 72 square feet for the total surface area. We've added that one sign for each entrance shall be permitted if the entrances are more than 1,000 feet apart, or if they're on different streets. That figure was arrived at by looking at some of the existing conditions with subdivisions that have more than one entrance and how much site distance you tend to need on our streets. In subsection C on that same page, where it's talking about signs for home occupations, we did not have a consensus on that. As it stands now, we're proposing that they be 2 square feet in area maximum. Councilor Jordan felt that they could be larger than that. He probably still does.
I still do.
But no longer, but no larger than 3 square feet.
That's right.
So between 2 and 3.
If anybody else wants input, we certainly welcome it. We've gotten good at dickering with some of this. For the subsection E on that page, talking about signs for municipal facilities, you have new language in what was presented to you this evening that I would like to go over. Sign area for each municipal facility shall not exceed a total of 150 square feet. It shall, all types of signs will be allowed in municipal facilities regardless of what zone they're in, and they must meet the provisions of the ordinance with a permit from the code enforcement officer. We were concerned about the number, the amount of square footage of signs allowed for municipal facilities. When I had this discussion last evening and this morning with ordinance committee members and the planner, we put in the 150 square feet. Part of that was because we thought there were 3 signs at the high school. There are only 2 signs at the high school. How do I know that? I went out and measured tonight. The signs at the high school would total 74 square feet. The sign at the on the public works building right now is 60 square feet. And the signs at the public safety building, there is a message board out front, double-faced, approximately 64 square feet. The Cape Elizabeth Fire Department sign over the fire engine bays is 30 square feet. The sign by the door into the police station is 50 square feet. I would propose that perhaps the 150 is excessive, that it could be 100 square feet rather than 150. And we can come back for that discussion, people so desire. We're proposing to add another subsection here, subsection F, at the bottom of the first page and what you received this evening, talking about projecting or suspended signs, putting that discussion here with some of the language taken out of the non-permitted use, saying that they shall not be erected over a right-of-way and shall maintain a 13-foot clearance over driveways. That's the biggest change there. It was not in a good place before. With a permit from code enforcement required, if it's a home occupation, it would require a permit from the Board of Zoning Appeals, which is the standard procedure. On to page 6, the chart, infamous chart. At the top of page 6, this is discussing permitted signs in the business zones. This evening's addendum has some additional language that makes this whole thing much easier to read and understand. Trust me, right? It talks about the signs that are allowed in the business zones. The total allowable sign area per establishment shall not exceed 75 square feet, except as provided elsewhere in this ordinance. The elsewhere will be with shopping centers and with gasoline stations. This is for all signs relating to an establishment, be they temporary or permanent signs, not to exceed 75 square feet. Also saying here that signs under this section, which shall be erected for a period not to exceed 120 days shall be considered temporary and require a permit from the code enforcement officer. This would be to allow what we would call temporary signs, be they banners, message board signs, or another sign that a fair number of our businesses in town have because they are seasonal businesses. The feeling was that the 120 days would allow them to have their signs up during their time of operation for our main summer season. In the one thing that was revised, going down through the chart, with wall signs, the maximum height of wall signs used to be 25 feet. It's now being put forth as 20 feet. With a banner, I don't know if any of you were as gasping as I was when I saw we had 60 square feet there for a double-sided banner. I see a few others were. So trying to fix that and say 40 square feet, which would be the same as a pole sign or a ground sign or a wall sign if it was two-sided, 30 square feet if it's one-sided. That would also include what I call the open flags that some of our businesses do put out. Those could be part of they could be a permanent flag if they were up the whole time, or if they want them just up for the summer, for the 120 day season, they would be temporary banners. Going down to window displays, we're dealing only right now with permanent window displays, saying that they may have a maximum exposure of 50% of the glass storefront. We have deleted temporary window displays, feeling that it was more of a headache to enforce that than it was worth. This puts no limit on temporary window displays. In the message boards, we would strike the word permanent out of what you have and what you got in your packets. We need only talk about message boards here, the temporary being taken care of in some of the new language up in sub A. Okay. The subsection B in a discussion about message boards has been revised in what you got this evening to read, no permanent message board shall be located within 750 feet as measured along the center line of the abutting roads of another permanent message board. If there's one permanent message board, you can't have another one within 750 feet. That covers adequately the existing permanent message boards in town. For instance, what sometimes could be a message board at the Agway and the Good Table. That's okay the way this is written. I can't remember how many feet apart it is. And the message board at the Public Safety Building and the ERA message board, which the distance there is about 1,100 feet, I believe. So the existing ones would be satisfactorily met with this kind of language. We're saying we don't need a discussion about temporary banners because we've talked about the time frame for temporary signs, which would include banners up above. So we would delete what you had, what is on there for subsection C. And that's it on that page. Moving along. Page 7. These are signs that are not allowed in any zone. And subsection A, talking about projecting or suspending signs, we would change that according to what was presented this evening to say projecting or suspended signs in excess of 6 square feet per face or 12 square feet in the aggregate. Those would not be allowed. Again, on page 7, we have working with the revised definition of roof signs, we would now say that roof signs are not allowed where they have more than 50% of the sign face above the roof or parapet line of the building. Going down to subsection E on that page, we took out colored lights. So it now says signs that are not allowed are signs with flashing lights, beacons, or moving parts. In section 21.4.1, under special sign standards, subsection B talks about wall signs, saying that they shall complement the materials of any building to which they are attached. Colors shall be compatible with the building facade and adjacent signs. We've taken out the discussion of the how many colors you can have on a sign. It's nice when the public gets us to use our common sense. I thank the public. At the bottom of that page, talking about the illumination of signs, we found the word processor had a mind of its own here. That should read, as you received this evening, illumination of signs from an external light source shall be shielded so as to prevent glare onto a public way or private property. We looked into how to regulate the illumination of internally lit signs. That seemed to be an objection held by some members of the community. And I've got to tell you, we found out we would probably be the only municipality in the entire country that had that kind of regulation. Of course, we had a couple of the Illumination Engineer Society or some group like that very interested and thought that maybe we would be a good case to pursue this for them and get a good write-up in some national magazine. We said, whoa, that we don't need. We also found that to have that objective kind of criteria would require extremely expensive equipment for us to enforce. It's not worth it. They're not that much of a problem. So what we've put in is some more subjective standards. And yes, they're not objective, not as easily enforced, but we're going to try to get back to some common sense on that and say that no sign shall be illuminated in a manner which creates a public hazard by adversely impacting the movement of people and vehicles and the enjoyment of adjacent properties. Your lighting shall minimize glare and reflection and shall be of an intensity and brightness in keeping with the general lighting area, lighting level of the area. Hopefully that's more easily dealt with by the community. Okay. On the next page, there are only some minor changes in what you received in your packet. This is talking about the signs for shopping centers. And then we go into the sign standards for gasoline stations. We have increased proposed square footage of signs for gasoline stations. We have more than doubled it. We previously had 120 feet, we're now saying 250 feet in the aggregate, meaning all the signs at the gasoline station combined. We came up with this figure after going out and measuring every single sign at one of the gas stations in town, which was just over 250 feet, but we thought some of them were redundant signs and hopefully would not be necessary. But I think that would cover all of the other gas stations in town quite adequately. That's the intent here. What we would, and there had been a question previously asked at our public hearing, I believe, would that be all of the signs on the gas station? How could you tell? Yes, that's for all of the signs at the gas station. So that differs from the 75 square feet and other business establishments. And then probably some of the best news for business people in this town is at the very end of this document, basically saying that all existing signs are grandfathered. So you can all go home now. What we're saying is, this is what we kept calling alternative D when we're talking about non-conforming signs. It would read, as we received tonight, any permanent sign not conforming with the standards of this ordinance at the time of its enactment may continue until such time that any substantial change other than normal maintenance is made to the sign. Normal maintenance shall include activities that keep the sign in safe, presentable, and sound structural condition, such as replacement of defective parts, periodic cleaning and painting, repairs due to vandalism, and seasonal removal and reinstatement of the same sign. And hopefully that will clarify what we mean by normal maintenance.
Thank you, Councilor McLaughlin. Comments from members of the council?
Very good.
Councilor Reed.
I just have a question where Pepsi and Coke vending machines ended up.
In Councilor Jordan's barn. We were hoping that one would go away and decided not to. I can tell you the Coke machine on the side of Jonesy's has 6.65 square foot of sign on it. They are internally lit, too.
But also, you could consider the fact that, yes, it is a sign, and a sign's primary function is to inform and notify.
Mm-hmm.
But the, quote, sign on the Coke and Pepsi machines, the primary function of that is dispense. It's a machine itself. And I think that's the way you can get around that kind of sign.
What do you mean by getting around?
Not considered a sign.
That is not considered a sign because the primary function is to dispense the Coke or Pepsi or fruit juice.
In my opinion, the primary part of that sign and why it's lit up is tell you whether you're at the Pepsi machine or the Coke machine.
Do you want to consider those signs, Councilor Jordan?
I went through it once in the committee. I guess we'll let it die at this point.
That's a good decision. I say that after sitting in on ordinance committee meeting several times and debating this around in circles, so I'm glad that it's finally worn it down. Any other comments, Councilor Amaro?
Madam Chairman, I would move that the sign ordinance be set for public hearing at March 13th meeting at 7:30.
Second motion. Discussion.
I would like clarification from the council about municipal facility signs. What square footage?
I would recommend 100 square feet.
I like that.
I too.
I like 100 square feet.
Wonderful. All those in favor? Settings for public hearing. It's a 7-0. We'll be at our next meeting. On to item number 138. To consider a report from the Riverside Cemetery Trustees regarding proposed changes in the bylaws for the cemetery and take any necessary action.
Madam,
is there someone?
137?
Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me. To consider, number 137, to consider a recommendation from the Planning Board regarding proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance, which would provide standards for recreational and athletic facilities in the business zone. Is someone present from the planning board who would like to give us some background? Would you come forward, please?
I'm Judith Kane. I'm a member of the planning board. We are proposing a change, a zoning text change for the recreational and athletics facilities. This was originally precipitated by a townsperson who wanted to put in an athletic facility use, primarily something more of like an aerobic center and a training center and a small gymnasium. The zoning that was allowed in the B zone was actually, interestingly, sort of things like tennis courts and miniature golf courses. And there wasn't really anything that addressed the particular use that had come up. We had a number of workshops on this. We went back and forth over whether we wanted a conditional use or a permanent use, a complete zoning text change, and we came up with having a zoning text change to allow this newer use. I just felt that when we had the original zoning ordinance, we didn't have this particular type of health facility, and it was a good time to include it so that they could come and without having to go back and forth between the boards. The items that we addressed in particular were the height of the building, parking, and the building bulk. We spent a lot of time working on how the particular building would look in the Business A zone, and made some changes on that, which are all in your memorandum, as well as the parking and the types of use and the bulk and size of the building in proportion to the amount of land that it would be on.
Thank you.
Anything else?
Any questions of Ms. Kane? What we basically will do will be to refer this to the ordinance committee for study. I thank you for your work and prompt response to our request for the change.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You have a lot more fun here than we do.
Stay.
Run.
Ms. Kane will be reviewing this Wednesday evening. Would you please join us? We have lots of fun from the ordinance committee.
Comments from Council McLaughlin.
Madam Chair, I just want to say for the planning board members who are present that I appreciate the work you've done. I think you took the right tack on this to amend the text language, and you're right, it's something that did not exist when the ordinance was drawn up. It would also be my assumption, and this is a good way to deal with it. With that, I would like to move that we refer this proposed text change to the ordinance committee.
Second.
Discussion?
And in addition to that, I will say it's on the agenda for the Ordinance Committee this Wednesday night, the 13th, if anybody is interested in joining us for discussion.
Now, what if we don't vote to refer it to you? What will you do?
Little assumption there.
Yes. Change the agenda.
That's good.
We're good.
All in favor? 7-0. Now we can move on to number 138. Consider a report from the Riverside Cemetery Trustees regarding the proposed changes in the bylaws for the cemetery and take any necessary action. Is there someone present from the Riverside Cemetery Trustees? I thank you for your patience finally getting on the agenda this late hour.
I'm Wayne Brooking. I'm the chairman of the Board of Trustees for the Riverside Cemetery. You may remember back in April, the council passed some changes to our rules and regulations, which was going to require the reprinting of this little booklet. And we thought at that time that it might be a good chance to overhaul the rest of the book and update some of the procedures to more reflect what currently is done. So we began that. And my fellow board members, Ray Hutchinson and Diane Chavanel, along with Debbie Pizzo, who is the prime administrator of the cemetery, and Sharon Murray, who is the consultant, we began our task. And we think we're finished. We hope we're finished. So I really don't know exactly how to begin, whether you've had a chance to study these changes. There's many of them, most of them relatively minor. I thought perhaps what I could do is just go through the sections. There's four basic sections to the rules and regulations, and we've made changes to all four sections, and I'll just go through each change if I could. Most of them, as I mentioned, most of them are minor. We did make, in the first section, which has to do with the purchase of lots and who may purchase the lots. We did change the language there a little bit we'd like to change the language to more to kind of soften the requirements of who can purchase space in the cemetery. If we go directly by the rules and regulations, it would only be residents and non-resident taxpayers. And we felt that there are some special cases where board approval would allow others to purchase space, such as someone who has relatives buried there, or someone who perhaps has lived in the town a long time and for one reason or another has had to move away and would like to buy space there. So that was one major change. to that section. We also rearranged some of the paragraphs in the section. We added in the buyback proposal, which was approved in April. That's about it. Several minor changes, but here again, a lot of them are redundant or obsolete since this was published in 1984. The next section had to do with interments. Several minor changes. Winter closure, we decided that the decisions on that should be with the Public Works rather than the Board of Trustees. So we wrote that in. Section 3, the care and decoration of lots. We added a restriction on tree planting. We felt that such trees are such a permanent and long-standing decoration that perhaps not anyone should just be allowed to plant a tree wherever they might like to. So the Board of Trustees would be required to approve tree planting. And then we came to Section 4, and this we had a lot of difficulty with this. The folks that have to administrate the memorials in the cemetery were having difficulty with sizes and with restrictions and interpreting what was intended in the rules and regulations. So we set about to, and in fact, some of these were improved in April, put some size restrictions on memorials. And basically what we've done is limited the height of the memorials to 36 inches and put various restrictions on sizes of how many memorials can be placed on one lot or on several lots that are contiguous to make a family space. And that's about it, I guess. I have any questions?
I want to thank you for your long process. I mean, that is what an undertaking. Do we have any questions from councilors? Councilor Jordan.
Madam Chairman, I have a couple of comments that I would like to make. I just feel maybe I'm looking at it wrong, but maybe. I think that the decision as far as where the winter months and what have you, that change should be to the manager and not the Public Works, because I feel it should is the town official, and he would look at his department head as a guidance of what the conditions were at the fort, and I feel that that should be the manager's decision and not his. Number two is, why are you not allowing artificial flowers?
First of all, that requirement was not changed. That was from the old, I believe.
Says here, artificial flowers may not be used.
That's true. I don't believe that's a change, is it?
No, it's not.
I believe that was in the section from before.
Yeah.
That's been there all along.
Okay, but I just want to know why is it?
Well, evidently, whoever wrote and approved this whole document didn't like artificial flowers.
As a florist.
And I don't like them either, so I wouldn't take them out. So.
Well, I read this quite thoroughly because I view the place quite often, and I think that artificial flowers, the way they are this day and age, look pretty damn good. I'll admit if they sit there for a month or two, they do fade and what have you, but they'll stay there and look much better a lot longer than regular flowers, which only last a week at the most, if not just 2 or 3 days. And I feel that should be looked at and have them be allowed, in my personal opinion.
I agree with you that they do look good, that they geraniums in December in the snow don't look too good. If they're maintained, taken care of, I could agree with you, but people don't do that. And that would be my...
Well, I understand by reading this, the guy that takes care of the cemetery, if the flowers are put there and they're left there too long, he has a right to pick them up and...
That's true.
And get rid of them. Mm-hmm. So why wouldn't that be the same as far as artificial flowers?
Probably would be.
Councilor Creelman.
I'm not sure if this is typeset or not, but on revision number 8, page 5, in the very last line, I believe it should say in written out Arabic 24, on the very last line, where it says not exceed 30.
All right, yes. That's a mistake in the type. That should be 24, I believe.
Okay.
Other comments?
I'll check that to be sure, and make sure that I correct that.
Okay.
No other comments. I'll take a motion on this item.
Excuse me, Madam Chair.
Yes, Councilwoman McLaughlin.
That 30 and 24. Are you saying it's 24 or 30?
Oh, up above it says 30.
Consistently, I would assume it would be 30 if it's a double.
No, we're getting
it's on a single lot.
Single lot,
so it should be 24. Okay.
It's probably 24.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I know this committee has done a lot of work on this. It may not be readily evident, but if you go through the old rules and regs and compare it to this, there's been a lot of work done. One thing that caught my eye, and I think it's fine, I don't know if there's any other language to describe the characteristics of a cemetery, but we're talking about perpetuating the rural characteristics of the cemetery, which is in keeping with Cape Elizabeth. It did cause me to chuckle, however. I don't know what other, if you would say, a cemetery with different kinds of alignments of the stones would be a different kind of characteristic. I'm not going to try to come up with the words, but I just found it ironic that we're also describing our cemetery as having the rural characteristics, for whatever that's worth. Madam Chairman, I would move that approve the proposed rules and regulations for the Riverside Memorial Cemetery as presented this evening.
Second.
Discussion? Councilor Reed.
may I please get a clarification on the artificial flowers question, because I also had that question. I mean, do we have a right to ask that they be allowed or that that be looked at, or what can we do?
We could do that if the majority wanted to, but Councilor McLaughlin has proposed accepting it as written, and if that is vetoed, then it could be.
So the process would be, if anyone wanted to make an amendment to Councilor McLaughlin's motion, someone could and second it, and if someone seconds it, it could be voted on, and then you vote on the main motion.
Councilor Amaral.
Or you could ask the committee to consider and to discuss it, to see what their feeling is and bring back a recommendation to us.
Do you feel, Mr. Brooking, that your committee did really discuss that issue?
It was discussed.
So the
decision was not to change it.
Fine. Okay.
I made my motion based on the fact that I prefer the real flowers as opposed to artificial.
I seconded with the same intent.
Okay. Real flowers.
Real thing.
Councilor Jordan.
I didn't get a comment from the manager on the decision.
The
public works director or the manager, what was his feelings? May I ask him?
I think that's a policy decision that the council should make.
Thank you.
On who ought to do it. No, my preference would be that the manager have the responsibility, but I'm not going to lose sleep over the council's decision on that.
Could that possibly be lengthening the whole process, though, if he has to contact you, or you could just do it automatically?
I don't know. The last time I got called, it was, it was over a weekend, and it was no problem. I think, it's anything. If they're not able to get a hold of me, or not able to get a hold of the public works director, they're going to get a hold of someone else. Usually, the decision is not too difficult to make because it's fairly obvious what the ground conditions are.
Would you, Councilor Jordan, want to propose an amendment that would change that wording?
Yes, I'll propose an amendment that maybe I better look it up here and see. I believe it's in two places, if I remember correctly. Well, I'll do it this way, that in the rules and regulations here, that where it says public works, that would be public works director, they'll be changed to the manager.
Is there a second to that?
I'll second that amendment.
Discussion? All those in favor of the amendment? One, two. This was a hard thought.
What was the amendment?
All opposed. The amendment is that the wording where the public works director is to make a decision that we would insert instead town manager. Now, would you like, shall we revote on that amendment? Those in favor of the amendment? We have opposed? One. 6-1. But Michael, you now have another responsibility.
A lot of 6-1 votes tonight.
Now we'll move on to the main motion, which is to approve the new rules and regulations for the Riverside Cemetery bylaws. All in favor?
I'll vote in favor, but I still think artificial flowers look good.
I will see protest. Your grave with artificial flowers.
That is a 7-0. And how do you feel about artificial strawberries?
Artificial strawberries look good. They look real good, but I don't say they eat good, but they look good.
Okay. Let's move on to item number 139, to consider a recommendation from the Portland Headlight Project Coordinator regarding staffing of the proposed museum and gift shop and take any necessary action. I have to thank Mr. Adams for being so patient. We have before us the letter from Mr. Adams. Do you want to come up and go over the job description in particular?
Now that I have the floor, I think artificial flowers are rather tacky. And I have particular empathy with the rules and regulations.
No, six of us voted that way, so we figured we'll keep
having written them.
Oh, originally.
But that, anyway, the item on the agenda is to consider the report and management of the Portland Headlight and Museum Gift Shop. And I guess you have the material in front of you. As I've explained in the letter, we've got to get the manager of the facility on board as soon as we can. There are a lot of things that have got to be done. The most important thing to be done is to begin the process of stocking a gift shop. At the same time, in the job description, you'll see that there's a lot of learning process that a manager will have to do in order to operate the facility. Also in the job description, you'll see that the manager of the gift shop has got to be able to solicit and manage a volunteer staff in order to operate the facility. And I feel, as Michael does, that if we delay this much longer, we're going to not be able to meet our objective of opening the entire facility at the middle of the summer. We're shooting for August 7th, still holding the architect's feet to the fire on this, but due to research matters that are taking place, it may be delayed a little bit as they come across some new ideas and new material. But it's well underway, and this is the next step that's got to take place. So that I'd be willing to answer any questions concerning the job description. If anybody has, yes.
Mr. Adams, all kidding aside, is there anyone in the world that fits this job description other than yourself?
Oh, there's got to be.
Are you a candidate?
No, I refuse to run.
Seriously?
No, I'm not a candidate for this whatsoever.
No.
The only thing I do is sell my house and move down there. That's no, I have taken this entire packet and I have shown it to several different people. And two of the people that I have shown it to said that a person like this does exist. What the salary would be, I have no idea. But we can't break this thing down at this point. We would like to advertise for a person, and in the job market the way it is, see if we can find a person that could do this type of work. If we can't, then we might have to vary it somewhat. But we're going to start at the main.
Do you feel that somewhere in here you should bring up the word business experience or purchasing experience? Because a lot of the duties do relate to that, and buying is really a talent and as well as learned experience.
Why could
they all break it down that these are business, you know, techniques, but I don't think it would hurt to have that inserted in there somewhere, such as management, purchasing. Councilor Amaral.
Is this person really going to be just a manager? I mean, this is not the person that's going to do the exhibits, et cetera, at the museum.
Oh, no. This is the person to be hired to run the museum after it's open. In other words, the exhibits will all be in place.
They're never going to change?
Well, at this point, there are five different exhibit areas that they're planning right now.
I thought two of the rooms were going to have rotating.
Well.
We're right in the phase
where the researchers have just about collected and researched their material, and the graphics people are now trying to design the exhibits. And once the exhibits have been designed and the graphics designers mind and they can put it down on paper, then the architects are going to alter the building. There's a very limited space inside. That's one reason the gift shop is out in the garage. It's very limited space, so that I think we're just about going to have room enough for what exhibits are you planning right now. In fact, there's about five that they're planning.
I guess I can understand where Councilor Amaral is coming from, because at one time they did mention the possibility of temporary short-term exhibits. But this would not be under the selection of this particular individual. This is strictly managerial, is that
this
correct?
This is strictly managerial person, someone who's going to take charge of the whole facility, make sure there's somebody somebody in the gift shop to run it, somebody in the museum.
Right. So who would be the person who would, or what committee would have the responsibility of selecting a temporary?
I took care of that by saying after this manager was hired at some point, I did mention that to whom this person reports is the responsibility of the manager and the town council to decide. I mean, I could think of all types of reorganizations for the town to accomplish this, but
Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, if I may, I think there's a couple different issues here. There's a real issue as to how the museum is going to be overseen. Mm-hmm. Is that correct, English? How it shall be overseen.
Oversawed.
I think it's a timely point. What I'd like to suggest is perhaps the council would like to have the appointments committee serve as a subcommittee to look over exactly, sorry, Jane, exactly, you know, what should be the governing board of the museum, how it ought to interact with the council, and how it ought to interact with other boards. How it shall be appointed, a number of issues. I think, you know, that's a real important policy question that a group ought to spend some time on, and I would suggest that perhaps the appointments committee might be a good group to do that. Second, while you recognize me before I don't get recognized again, one thing I would like to suggest, and I hadn't really discussed this with Henry, but listening tonight, is that we entitle this position Museum Director / Gift Shop Manager. Because I think that's really what it is that we're looking for, and you know, and the job title ought to fit the job description. Third, the final issue that still has not been resolved, but perhaps it can be when we look at the governance issue, is exactly who the museum director / gift shop manager will report to in the municipal organization. And that has not been resolved as of yet, but I think it ought to be discussed in the context of my suggestion that the appointments committee look at that, because that is a governance issue. It's an important issue.
Yes.
And, you know, while I have my preferences, I think that the council ought to have significant input to that before we publicly come forward with some plan.
So moved.
Yes, Councilor Jordan.
Thank you.
If I may answer the comment from the manager, that I think the whatever the title of the gentleman is, he should report to the manager.
What?
And the manager then come back to the council. That would be my interpretation. Now, is this gentleman, lady,
person,
director, manager, or what? Is what I call a working manager, or is he has an office and makes sure everybody else does the work and he just oversees it? That way he's not allowed in the to be able to sell you a postcard or anything like
no,
that.
No, I would.
No.
In the assistant, we got to have an assistant to be able to do that. Is that correct?
No. In the original letter, it said perhaps an assistant manager may have to be hired, but there are already people have called me from outside the town of Cape Elizabeth that want to volunteer as volunteers in the museum, so that if you get, you know, you can, for instance, the gift shop at Mercy Hospital is run entirely by volunteers. There's no professional help whatsoever. So gift shops can run, but that's, the gift shop is going to be the most important project of this whole thing, and that's probably where the manager probably should spend most of the time.
Okay, thank you. I don't want to get too many titles here and nobody does anything, and then we got to ask volunteers to so we can pay our way here. Got another question, if I may, Madam Chairman.
Yes.
As I read the front page, it's recommended the operation of the museum at Pullen Headlight and the gift shop under the sole control of the town of Cape Elizabeth, all the proceeds and what have you. And I take it when you say in the sole control of the town of Cape Elizabeth, you mean the town council, is that right?
Well, I'm referring to this whole thing, the town
yeah,
of Cape
okay.
Elizabeth.
Yeah, okay. On the back page, the manager of the museum at Pullen Headlight and the museum gift shop will have overall responsibility of the buildings at Pullen Headlight to include the keeper's quarters and the garage. Now, when you say responsibility, is that the upkeep of the buildings and all such stuff as
no,
that,
well,
or is that just what's inside of the buildings?
No. This person who is going to manage the facilities obviously should have some consideration and some care for the exterior of the buildings. In other words, coming in the morning, the fence is down, the lattice work fence on the porch is down or something. In other words, the person who's responsible, who's going to manage this facility, should be responsible for the whole thing, the exterior, the interior, the garage, if the shingle's gone. In other words, it's the museum that I'm running, and therefore I'm responsible for seeing that it's taken care of.
Well, you interpret that different than I do, that's all.
No.
I understand what you're saying, but you interpret it different than I do.
It's like if the town hall isn't shoveled out in the morning, I'm responsible for seeing that no one slides on the steps, and you know, one way or another, I'm responsible to make sure it's shoveled and safe. I may not necessarily do it, I try to get someone else, but if I'm out there and those steps have snow on them and no one else is available, I do them. And I would expect that this person would do similar type things. Debbie's done them too. Yeah. Do what needs to be done.
I spread sand the other day because it was slippery too.
Thank you.
Thank you, Counselor. Any other comments from members of the council? Yeah. Counselor Amaro.
This job.
I like that better.
It's not going to cost to the town, right?
It is envisioned that the entire museum complex will be self-supporting, and then some.
And what did we envision that this position might pay?
we haven't. It's still a vision.
It got real foggy then.
Mike and I have discussed all kinds of salaries. I think we got to wait and see who applies and discuss salaries.
Do you have some range you're talking about?
Yeah, we're talking an hourly rate plus maybe a percentage of the proceeds of the gift shop or something of that nature in order to...
So you're not really looking for a museum director at an hourly rate. You're looking
for a manager.
A caretaker, more or less, sounds like.
No.
No.
I think going, harking back to Mr. Adams' point of a few minutes ago, the museum, for the most part, is going to be fairly static. It isn't going to require a whole lot of work in terms of time. Where the real challenge is going to be is in the gift shop portion of it, because that is forever changing, is going to need constant attention as to inventory, as to the financial end of it, and a lot of other issues. You know, what we're really looking at for is someone that is really interested in being entrepreneurial, someone who will ensure that we maximize our profit out of the gift shop, and will without and still providing good services and all those things, to ensure that we get the best possible return and the customers get the best possible product. You know, I usually start lower. Henry goes higher as to salary and as to wages. We're not talking a whole lot of money, regardless. Henry looks at what I look at. In discussing it with different people, you know, particularly as Henry indicates, the percentage of the profits thing, we're really on the fence about that. But I think it really, you know, for it to succeed, if someone has an incentive, you know, the old capitalist line, we can do a lot better. And I think, you know, just because a government runs it, it ought not to be run like a government service. It ought to be run like a business. We're looking for someone that can do that. Not that I want to denigrate government, but there is something to be said for profit incentive.
Madam Chairman,
yes, Mr. Jordan.
Follow up on Councilor Amrow's question. Could I get your low and his high and jot it down as some idea?
Well, I was talking $8 an hour.
Well, you're way low.
Yeah. And this is how many hours a week is expected as a minimum?
40 hours a week.
It would generally be 40, and we'd try to limit it to that because we don't want to get into Fair Labor Standards Act problems. It's awesome. Remember, not a year-round position. So, you know, we may need someone to do occasional things like during this time of year, but it'll be at a, you know, just a few hours.
Right. This would be the buying season anyway.
Yeah.
What's the high?
Whoa! Something in the vicinity of $40,000-$50,000. No, I really.
No, Henry.
No, now we can shoot for something in the middle. You see.
Okay.
No, but I don't. I have really. You know, knowing that some places operate wholly on volunteers, there are people out here who fit this bill, and I'm sure we'll find them. In this day and age, with the market the way it is,
I think I prefer your title, Mr. Adams, of manager rather than director. I think that is a little misleading of sorts. Councilor,
Madam Chairman, if I may.
Yes, you may.
I volunteer to put an end to this conversation, and I will, in the next week or so, research diligently what other titles are classified at other museums of this sort. And compare it to art museums that have gift shops and the like, yeah. And conjure up what it's actually.
Well, you can't use the word curator,
no.
Because we're not in that type of a museum. This is a fixed, static museum. We're not accepting things and researching and keeping them under certain conditions.
We do have a book, the museum store book, which is about yay thick, that has all sorts of that data from museums all over the country.
Yeah, the architect.
We're not doing this in a vacuum. We do have a source.
At a future date, we can also clarify the title if we need to.
And right now, we're looking
and change the job description. Yeah. But perhaps in order to be able to continue the process, we're sort of spinning our wheels. If we could just consider this item. And at least approve the job description as it was presented tonight, perhaps with some reference to business experience.
Yeah.
Then they could start this process. But we do need to give them some sanction in order to move ahead. And it is getting late in the buying season. If you're going to be opening any kind of a shop, you probably have missed some of the trade shows. I don't know.
Well, the biggest trade show is happening in the middle of March with the main trade show in the Cumberland County Civic Center.
Okay, so we...
And I want to get a manager online so I can unload the briefcase of mine and all the boxes I got at home for stuff that's coming in.
So how... Can we have a motion on this item?
Motion to approve this? I'll make a motion we don't approve. How's that?
You may make whatever motion you want. Whether or not the rest of us agree, we'll find out in the final vote.
Okay. I got something to say to Mr. Adams before he sits down. I'll make a motion that we approve. Pretty hard for me, and I don't agree with it all. To approve the recommendation for a Portland Headlight Project Coordinator.
No.
Or a manager to manage the gift shop and the museum at Fort Williams.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor of the motion? Opposed? 7-0.
And I promise you there won't be any artificial gifts in there either.
I'll move for a 5-minute recess. Okay, well then I'll go without the motion then. I'll be right back. And Henry, those flowers may be tacky to you, but they look good to me. And your logo, I think, had to grow on me before I could look at it twice.
Those flowers don't grow on you though.
Okay, let's go on to item number 140 to consider a report from the town manager regarding the Maine Department of Environmental Protection's position on paving the proposed Farm Pond Road emergency access lane. Michael.
Yes, I finally, after 4 or 5 phone calls, spoke today to Deb Richard, who is the director of the Land Bureau for the Maine Department of Environmental Protection. As you can recall, last month the council agreed to accept all the public improvements that are part of the proposed Broad Cove Highland subdivision, with the one exception that the road you wanted paved instead of gravel. Well, we did appeal that decision, the earlier decision in an informal sense, to the director of Deb Richard of the Land Bureau. She finally called me back this morning and said that she and her staff believed that a paved emergency access road would take away from the aesthetic and scenic qualities of the adjacent protected wetland. I asked her if there was room for appeal. She said that it could be appealed to the Board of Environmental Protection. I think it's very important and remains important that we have some sort of emergency access out of Broad Cove. What I would suggest is that you approve the gravel emergency access road subject to no lots being sold except the Jordan Farmhouse lot. This is the one on Two Lights Road that really doesn't matter in terms of the roadway itself. It's already served. Until the applicant has appealed the decision on the approval of the subdivision to the Board of Environmental Protection. If the board should rule in favor of the applicant, then a paved road would be acceptable to the town. The only thing he would be appealing is paved versus gravel. If the board reaffirms the staff decision of the DEP, then the road could remain gravel. In other words, you'd be putting this into the hands of the Board of Environmental Protection. And it would put the burden on the developer, Peter Kennedy, to actually appeal it and see what happens. And we would work with the developer to present the best case that we could to the DEP. The other point is the way this is structured either way, it should not hold up Mr. Kennedy and further create financial problems for him. Thank you.
Comments? Councilor McLaughlin?
I haven't I've dealt with DEP. I have not dealt with the Board of Environmental Protection. I'm wondering if Mr. McGovern knows a typical time frame, if there is such a thing, for dealing with the board.
It depends on what their other business is. You know, I'm not too sure what their other business is at this point, but my guess is 3 months. You know, it's a very simple issue. Yes, gravel. Yes, paving. You know, it's a matter of getting on the agenda. I wouldn't expect that it would take, once it was on the agenda, it would take more than one meeting, but you know, I'm not sure what their other business is at this point.
Okay, one never knows about some of that. Do you know what kind of application is required to go to the board? Is it the same amount of material that's required to go to DEP?
No, I'm not an expert on that. My sense is that all that could be appealed, since they've already approved, the initial order has been approved by staff, doesn't need to go to the board. It's a very narrow issue that would be going to the board. My sense is, you know, we would have to address that narrow issue, but, you know, I've never had to file an application with the board, so I'm not an expert on it.
One of my concerns would be that there be a time delay in this procedure because an incomplete application was filed, and I would strongly recommend, as you have put forth, that if this is the route we choose to follow, that the town provide technical assistance to the developer in making this application. I don't want to hear a lot of moaning and groaning coming back to us that couldn't get on the VEP agenda. Well, why not? Well, the application wasn't complete. That kind of excuse I will look upon very harshly. And I'm wondering, I don't know what the procedures are up there. I didn't hear about this till this afternoon, so I haven't found out. Would the town be in a position to present testimony to the board?
Yes, okay. I do know that. I've also worded this, in, you know, the final paragraph from the sheet in front of you, that it wouldn't stop him from starting construction work. All it does is prohibit lots from being sold. So, you know, he could start putting the gravel road in under this proposal. The only thing that he would be stopped from doing is selling lots, other than the one lot. So, you know, it's in his best interest, if this was approved, to move aggressively with the BEP. Mm-hmm. Of course, the other option you do have, since you want to know all the options before you, mm-hmm. is to, you have two other options. One is to say, tough luck, essentially things are dead. I wouldn't advise that because you'd have quite the lawsuit on your hands, and you know, your grounds may not be too good on just this one issue. Your second option is to fold your cards and say, you know, we've done what we can. We accept the decision of the DEP.
I would not like to see us fold our cards at this point. I believe the DEP is making a decision that I disagree with. The aesthetic and scenic qualities of the wetland, you're looking at the wetland regardless of what kind of road surface you're traveling on. The DEP order, as I said last month, also talks about the rural character. I'll reiterate, that is not determined by whether you're on a gravel road or a paved road. That's based on the density of development. You can have a paved road in a very rural character. I really don't understand where DEP is coming from with this. And as I said, I've had numerous occasions to deal with them. This is one time I really am perplexed and would think it's worth the town's while to have the developer pursue this to the Board of Environmental Protection. I do not envision that being a major expense for the developer. And if he is allowed to proceed with construction, if he gets all of his approvals from the planning board, it would not be an expense to him construction-wise. He might even get to the point where he puts in a gravel road right there while waiting for the BEP decision. Depending on the decision, it would stay gravel or he put pavement over it with the same kind of base material.
So are you making a motion?
Not yet. I think other councilors want to make some points.
Councilor Amaral.
Yeah, it was my understanding last month when we talked about this, when the developer was here, that we said we wanted to try again with the DEP and get a decision from them. And that pretty much what I thought we were saying is if they continue to say it's just on the gravel road, that we'd say, all right, we'll go ahead. And now we're saying, well, let's try one more avenue. The developer isn't here, and I don't know what his reaction would be, and I'm really not sure how much this is going to cost as far as delays go and the inability to sell those lots, whether that's critical or for the development.
Councilor Reed?
I concur with Councilor Amaral. Excuse me, I am not at this time willing to support any additional restrictions on the developer. I felt that my vote last month was that we would try, and if it failed, then he would be able to proceed without this additional condition.
Councilor Creelman.
That was my understanding.
Okay, that was sort of the way the vote ended up being formalized as a motion, but our discussion previous to the actual motion was that we really felt that that this was basically a bad precedent to have the gravel road approved. We also, the developer knew that this would be coming up on our agenda again this month, and we did say that we would take the recommendations from the Board of Environmental Protection, and one of her suggestions was that there is an appeal process that we could follow. I would like to see that we do support and help the developer with an appeal. I feel somewhat bewildered by the Department of Environmental Protection, who will give approval for miles and miles of wetland alteration for turnpike expansion, and who feels that it's sort of taking away our powers as a town council when we have the responsibility of protecting the health and safety of the town and have basic requirements for all sorts of roads, that now they say, no, you can't live up to your ordinances and your standards. You have to do as we say. So I really think that we should not fold our cards, to reiterate what Michael and Jenna have said, and that we should pursue this last step. Michael.
I'd just like to explain in that sort of draft motion I have in the last paragraph there. If you look at it, it doesn't prohibit him from selling lots once the application to the board is in. What I was trying to do here was just force an application to be filed so then we could go and defend it. This draft does not specifically require the developer to do anything more than to file the appeal. You know, I'm willing to go fight it for the town, and if the developer shows up, fine. If he doesn't, fine. So the only burden this draft puts on the developer is to sign an appeal. It doesn't require for an actual board vote prior to him being allowed to sell lots. So I was trying not to put too much of an impact. Because I had that same fear that once I called the developer, they're doing it to me again.
Carl, Councilor Pearson.
That's
excuse
okay.
me. It's late.
I'd like to just make the motion that we approve the gravel road subject to blah 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 as stated, and that the developer, when he puts in his gravel road, do so conforming with the substructure that is necessary for a paved road, and that he file the appeal and that we pursue it. But to let him get along with his other criterion that he's going to have to pass through the other, the planning board and everyone else. But at least this gets the process going, the substructure's in place. We can, you know, support his appeal, but make that a condition that he file for the appeal.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Further discussion, Council McLaughlin.
A question about, you know, the planning board members have left, that's too bad, about going through the review process with the town. Does the applicant have to have in hand all final approvals from outside agencies before the town can grant final subdivision approval?
He needs an acknowledgement from the council that they're willing to accept the public improvements. Mm-hmm. He would have that. He would need a decision from the Board of Environmental Protection. He already does have that in its current form. The only thing I think we're looking for is a note on the linen that if the board hadn't decided this prior to the town, that the road would be the paved or gravel dependent on that decision. He does, in fact, already have the approval.
Okay. Thank
for the
you.
Road. It's just an issue of what will its final treatment be. And a lot of times, you know, that probably you know from your experience, you put those little notes on the plans and you can address issues that are unresolved or, you know, something still needs to be done that is required.
Different municipalities operate differently. I needed to know how this town dealt with it. Thank you.
Of course, in the end, it's how the planning board wants to, you know, the final judgment is this. Yeah. But there is room for movement.
Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
It was my understanding before that the same as the rest of them is that we would go with a gravel road if that's what they said, one of you. And I would just like to comment on something that you just made a comment about as far as them approving other wetlands or one of you. And a DEP employee told me at a meeting that I was at with a manager that, which I was quite surprised, and I asked her twice, if not three times, that life safety isn't in their decision making.
Other comments? If not, I'll move the motion. All in favor of the motion? Opposed? Which way did you go?
No, I would just like to hear it again. I'm sorry. Is it too late to ask that question?
Do you have
I know, that's my
you want
problem.
Me to blah, blah, blah?
It was the blah, blah, blah. Blah, right. Blah.
No, I made a motion to approve the gravel emergency access road subject to no lots being sold except the Jordan Farmhouse lot until the applicant has appealed the decision to the Board of Environmental Protection and made an addendum to that the substructure of that road be prepared, that it could be overlaid with asphalt.
Well, that's not what I thought.
No?
I second. I'm sorry.
Why?
And then you went on to say.
Continue on with what I said. I'm confused. I lost myself.
Didn't you say that we would?
We would support the appeal of that.
Of his
decision.
Appeal.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
If he would bring the appeal.
Mm-hmm. In other words, he was to file the appeal, and we would support the appeal. We would pursue the B.
All he had to do was file.
He had to file.
The BEP. He had to file, and we would support his file, or support the pursuit of that file.
Yeah, I understand that. I thought when you said it, you didn't read this motion, did you?
I blah 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 it.
Okay. All right. I thought you had said that we would move to approve the gravel road and encourage the developer to file a DEP.
I put subject to him appealing to the DEP.
Oh, okay. I'd like to withdraw my.
I will second the motion.
Are we clear on the motion now?
I am.
All in favor of the motion?
What are we undoing what we did before?
Jane is withdrawing her second because she wasn't, the motion wasn't clear.
Okay.
Are you clear on the motion now?
Cloudy and clear.
Cloudy and clear. Okay. Let's vote while it's clear. All in favor? One, two, three. Opposed? 5-2. Getting more difficult, I have to count. It's not automatic. Okay. Item 141, to consider establishing a recycling committee and take any necessary action. As a result of the Main Street 90 project, which consisted of about 9 different segments, a recycling subcommittee was formed, and they did a remarkable job of educating the public, working with the schools, helping along with the regional waste to set up the bins, is that the correct name, for recycling at the transfer station. And their final recommendation from E.J. Silk, who was chairman of that committee, was that the town establish a recycling committee. And she also recommended that the town adopt a recycling ordinance. So we have before us tonight the language for establishing the recycling committee. There is hereby established a Cape Elizabeth Recycling Committee, which shall consist of 5 citizens appointed by the town council utilizing its appointments committee process. Of the members first appointed, 1 shall have a term expiring on March 1, 1992, 2 on March 1, 1993, and 2 on March 1, 1994. Future terms shall be for 3-year periods unless a member is filling an unexpired term. The committee charge is 1, to develop an educational program to encourage recycling among the citizenry and businesses of the community. 2, work with school officials to encourage recycling and recycling education within the schools. 3, evaluate progress towards meeting state recycling goals, which are currently 25% by 1992 and 50% by 1994. Number 4, provide recommendations to the town council on amendments needed to the refuse disposal ordinance. Number 5, explore additional waste reduction, reuse, and recycling possibilities. Number 6, participate in regional recycling efforts when such efforts are deemed to be in the best interests of the community. Number 7, perform such other tasks as may be requested by the town council.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? Jane? Councilor Amaro?
Yes. I'd like to ask for the council to consider the possibility of allowing up to 5 citizens if they were interested.
Up to 7?
I mean, up to 7 citizens if that many people express an interest in serving on the committee. And then we have to adjust the terms to be consistent.
I'd be happy to modify my second if the motion is modified.
Is the motion modified?
No. The way I would put it is 5 members and 2 alternates would be the way I'd rather see it.
I think the alternate really works better in a board that has a full review process like zoning or planning. But a studying committee basically is a working committee. It's not quite the same status.
The reasoning on the larger number as a possibility is that if we're expecting people to do an educational program, the more bodies that you have to do it. And people seem to think that there's a lot of interest out there at this time, and it might only last, you know, for 2 or 3 years until we get the program really going, and then we could go back to a 5-person board. So it would give some flexibility to say up to 5.
You talked me into it.
Oh, 7.
I mean, up to 7. Okay.
I guess we're going to start with 3.
Okay, how would you modify the terms, Michael?
Of the members first appointed, well, it depends on if you want to do 7.
Well, assuming we do.
Yes, it's changed to 7.
If you do it to 7, then you...
2, 3, 2. Oh, no.
You could do it the same way the council is done, the same wording that's in the charter. 3, 2, 2. 2, 2, 3.
2, 2.
223. You probably want to do it.
So is there an amended motion?
Excuse me, before we do an amended motion, I have some other possible amendments. Perhaps we can do it all at once. Before I'll do that, I have a question. Who would we think from the town, who'd we envision staffing this? Are we visionary on that?
I haven't given it a whole lot of thought. You know, Bob Malley would do a little bit of it, but for the most part, I think this group could be fairly self-supporting up to now. The recycling committee has shown that they're able to do a lot on their own, and I don't see any reason why you couldn't continue that.
Okay, thank you. When I looked through the committee charge language, I was a bit concerned that some of it didn't sound to me like it was going, like it was referring to an ongoing standing committee, that was sounding more like a short-term committee. And in looking it over in that light, I'd like to try some additional language and see how it flies. In number one, I would say develop and pursue an education program. I think it's only developed, we're not putting forth that this is what we expect to be a continuum. In number two, work with school officials to encourage ongoing recycling and recycling education. Just adding the word ongoing there. And in number six, I have some concerns that I believe it should be the council who's setting the policy, whether we participate in regional recycling activities. And I'm not sure that's clear from this language. I think if we were to say that this group was to evaluate the town's participation in these regional efforts and make a recommendation to the council, I would then envision some of those members possibly being involved more, but I think that I'd feel better if it was clarified that the council's going to make that final decision in number six. Thank you.
Do you have those changes, Debbie? Is everyone clear as to the proposed changes? Mr. Jordan, you were the original person to make the motion. Do you accept these changes, or do you withdraw your motion?
No, I'll accept the changes.
Okay, and the second also agrees?
Yes, I'll accept those.
Okay, any discussion? All in favor? There, you only vote once, I'm sorry, Counselor. It is 6-0, a proxy, yes. That's the business, okay. Now, item 142, to consider approving, I think perhaps we'd best have a motion to continue after 11 o'clock first before.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? Onto item 142, to consider approving several stop signs on the school grounds and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, these are existing stop signs, and this just ensures that they're legitimate.
That they're enforceable.
Enforceable.
Is that not the word you used? Janet?
I would like to see them enforced.
That's, yeah, Counselor Reed had made that mention to me, and I had discussed it with the chief, and this is just to make sure, this is dotting the I and crossing the T to, if they go out there and enforce, they can say yes. If they go into court and someone challenges it, that the municipal officials, the officers have adopted them.
I think these signs are well-placed, and if I vote to approve them, I will expect to see some enforcement action. I'm appalled by the traffic patterns. Anyway, this is one minor step to alleviate some of the circulation problems and the speeding through the school lots. We've talked about those circulation concerns previously this evening. It's not a good situation. If this is going to help, it has to be enforced. With that, I move that we approve the four stop signs as presented in the memo.
Second? There's a second? Discussion? Counselor Jordan?
I just want to ask the manager, evidently the one at the high school exit onto 77 has already been approved and is enforceable? Is that what you're saying here?
Yes, that was an early one. And I'm pretty sure the one coming out of the back end of the high school was approved too. But this lays it out again. You know, if you want to add that as number five, so they're all on one list, that'd be fine. You know, the stop signs that actually you might put five and six. The one at the end of the mall as it hits Scott Dyer Road.
Yes.
And the one at the end of the high school driveway as it hits Route 77.
That's acceptable.
Sounds good. That's
acceptable. Second, too. Mm-hmm. And they're all on a very neat list. Discussion. All in favor? This is a 7-0. It's easy to count that way. Item number 143, to consider if the town council wishes to consider a resolution proposed by the town meeting initiative of the Peace Economy Project and take any necessary action. Councilor Amaro.
Madam Chairman, I move that this item be tabled indefinitely.
Second.
Dear?
All in favor? 7-0.
Dear Carol, I hope she didn't hear those seconds.
Just put down a bunch of seconds.
Item number 144, to consider certifying the acceptance of state funds and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes. As you note here, Sawin Mellett, the commissioner of the Department of Finance for the state, sent a letter on January 15th to Debbie Pizzo indicating that there's a state statute that requires municipalities to accept all state funds, and this is merely a proposed form that, you know, I would suggest that all the different categories be checked off and that the clerk sign it on behalf of the municipal offices.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Item number 144, to consider a proposed resolution relating to property tax relief and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, elsewhere in your packet, you saw a proposed resolution almost demanding property tax relief. This particular resolution was drafted in such a manner that if you read through it carefully, it does not specifically require any additional taxation. It strictly asks particularly a stronger emphasis on the circuit breaker program, that be as widely promoted, that there be municipal fiscal impact notes on all legislation, on administrative regulations, that the current educational funding formula continue to be utilized, that a sunset review take place of all state mandates to determine if they're truly necessary, and that if a delay in them would be truly detrimental to the citizens of the state. And finally, the establishment of state-local partnership task force to review the relationship of municipal governments and state government. I think what's unusual about this resolution, if it's adopted and it's sent up to Augusta, is that it's not going to be the standard, just another resolution that came from 400 other municipalities.
Comments from councilors?
I think it's great that you put in the additional things that set Cape Elizabeth aside, and particularly the support for the present educational funding formula, and also setting up the task force, which I think is long overdue.
I'll take a motion.
I move that the town council pass this resolution supporting property tax relief.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor? 7-0. Item number 146, to consider a report from the Appointments Committee and take any necessary action. Councilor Amaro is chairman of the Appointments Committee.
I'm sorry this is so late, because we did tell people that we talked to that we would be acting on these recommendations tonight, and that they could either be here or watch, and we do have one person who's here, which is really great, and probably very few watching at home, but I did promise that I would read all these names, so I'm sorry it's so late, but please bear with me. We had
as usual, outstanding applicants again this year. After I read this, and if you accept the report, all of our committees will have full membership. We have no vacancies. Okay, and these are the people that I would recommend to fill the various positions on our boards and councils. For the Area Development Council, Carol McMullen, who's sitting right here. Congratulations, Carol. For the Planning Board, the three-year terms, Tom Emery and Stephen Parkhurst. For the two associate positions on the Planning Board, Tim Eichenberg and Judy Ladner. For the Zoning Board, for the three-year positions, Bruce Sarbeck, Bob Cronin, and Larry Clough. And for the two associate positions on the Zoning Board, Wyatt Garfield and Judy Dooley. For the Board of Health, Dr. Merle Backerstaff. For the Board of Assessment Review, two positions, Glenn Black and Kenneth Gray. For the Conservation Commission, Gary Weaver. Riverside Cemetery Trustees, Ray Hutchinson. The Thomas Memorial Library Trustees, Susan Busby and Janet Hawks. The Community Services Advisory Board, Russell Erickson. Cape Elizabeth Cable TV Advisory Board, Kathleen Harris and William Hosmer. The Fort Williams Advisory Commission, Jeffrey Van Fleet, Barbara Sanborn and Nancy Jackson. For the Board of Historical Preservation Advisors, Jane Jordan and Mary Clark Webster. For the Arts Commission, Claudia Finkelstein and Jane Sneerson. And then we had two resignations during the appointments process. So we have two people to fill unexpired terms, the term of Polly Morrison to be filled by Rachel Perry, and that of Steve Micheletti to be filled by Michael Crowley. The Board of Harbor Commissioners, Michael Monroe. The Board of Sewer Appeals, Ralph Romano and Gary Kinski. The Personnel Appeals Board, Robert Packer. Family Fun Day, Ann Chapman. I will move approval of these people for the boards and commissions as read.
Second motion.
Discussion. All in favor?
Oh, yes.
Opposed? None. 7-0. Item number 147, to consider changing the date of the regular March meeting of the Town Council from March 11, 1991 to March 13, 1991, and taking the necessary action. The reason for changing the date is that two of our councils will be out of town on town business, and so we wish to accommodate them. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Item number 148, to consider referring the proposed municipal, county, Riverside Cemetery, and sewer fund budgets to the Finance Committee and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, I will keep this very brief due to the lateness of the hour. The council has, councilors have all received tonight their budget notebooks. At the front of the budget notebook is a budget message. I was rereading the town charter last week when I was about to write this budget message to see what it said, to see what I had to do. And what it said is I had to recommend a budget for the of appropriations. I was debating what to write because I really couldn't recommend this budget. So what I've done in order to fulfill the charter requirement is that I've recommended this budget, recommend the appropriations contained herein as a portion of what needs to be funded in order to continue to provide a good level of services for Cape Elizabeth citizens. This budget is 6.5% less than last year as a result of severe revenue loss. It provides for a property tax increase. And I think we'd be kidding ourselves if we thought we could reduce the budget by 6.5% in a time of inflation of 6% and still meet all the needs and services that have been provided in this particular fiscal year. So I see before us a very difficult budget process, but one that, in spite of my comments at this late hour, will be, I think, one that's very cooperative and challenging for everyone. And I look forward to April 8th or whatever the date is when we finish the budget. One other final point I would like to make is, when I think the budget goes through different stages. At the beginning, it's a department head's budget, and the manager and the accounts that he oversees. It's a manager's budget right now when it goes to the council. At this point, it is truly the council's budget. You know, you make the decisions, you make the priorities, you listen to the debates, you listen to department heads, the public, you listen to everyone. Then you adopt the budget, and then it really becomes the manager's budget again to implement and to carry out. So, you know, as you have your hands on this budget during the next month and a half, take full advantage of all the policy deliberations that you have before you. And, you know, it's a real opportunity for you to set forth your priorities and send a whole lot of messages, not only to myself, but also to the department heads, as well as to the citizens. So enjoy it.
I move that we refer the proposed municipal, county, Riverside Cemetery, and sewer fund budgets to the Finance Committee.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor? 7-0. This is the point in the agenda where we have citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda.
When I forgot to put something on the agenda tonight, and I'm not proposing to be added, but you had asked for the deer reduction program report. I did receive that, and I, for whatever reason, I don't know, didn't get it on the agenda. So that will be on the agenda at your March meeting. And what it recommends is that if a deer reduction or deer depredation program continues, that it be a private matter between the Department of Inland Fisheries and Wildlife, whatever it's called now, and citizens, and that the police department not have you know, anywhere near as active a role as they had this year. So that will be, you will be getting that report with your next packet, and that's essentially what the recommendation is with them. So I apologize for not having it for you tonight, as I had indicated that I would.
Thank you, citizen. Anyone else? There being no one coming forward, we'll say goodbye.
I got one comment.
Yes?
When the manager outlined the budget here, and he had a little quote in the pulling paper here the other day, that the excise tax was down 23% less in January than of a year ago. He says, if the wealthy feel forced to stop buying cars and other big ticket items, how can the rest of us be expected to go on a spending spree? So that fits your budget real good.
I hope you made clear that latter part was not in quotations.
He didn't say that.
It's not in quotation. I'm just reading what was in the paper.
But that's
it sounded like you were quoting the manager.
I'll take a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Good night, one and all.